Little Moffat by Eleanor Estes. Chapter 4. An Afternoon with the Oldest Inhabitant. Jane took the shortcut across the huge empty lot to the library. She was in a hurry because she had just gotten the idea that it would be fine to read every book in the library. Of course, not all at once, just one at a time. She arrived there hot and panting. The best way to go about reading every book in the library, she thought, was to go to a certain section, take down the first book on the first shelf, get it stamped, take it home, read it, bring it back, and take out the very next book. In this way, she would not miss one single book. She tiptoed over to one of the sections, took down the first book without looking to see what it was, and had it stamped at the desk. As she was about to leave, she noticed Mr. Buckle in an armchair by the window. "What books did you take, mysterious Middle Moffat?" he asked her. Jane showed him her book. She saw for the first time it was called The Story of Lumber. The Story of Lumber. Very mystifying, he said. Put his forefinger on the side of his nose, like Hawkshaw the detective. Jane played her part too, and then she backed out on tiptoes, waving a reassuring goodbye to Miss Lamb, the librarian, who watched her with a truly mystified expression. Jane read The Story of Lumber as rapidly as possible. It was not very interesting. But if she were going to read every book in the library, she would have to take the bad along with the good. She brought The Story of Lumber back the next day and took the next book. The oldest inhabitant was sitting in the same place by the window. His soft white hair shone in the sunshine. Again, Jane showed him the new book she had borrowed and saw with a trace of dismay that this was one called The Story of Cotton. "The Story of Cotton? More mystifying than ever," whispered Mr. Buckle. Jane played Hawkshaw a trifle absentmindedly. She sat down on the granite steps outside the library and read for a while. This book was also far from interesting. Evidently, she had chosen the wrong section to begin on. Where were all the books like Heidi? Still, if she read the bad ones first, the good ones would be like dessert. And when she brought back Story of Cotton and saw that the next book was The Story of Sugar, she decided to try something different. She still planned to read every book in the library, but she would take the best ones first. Then, by the time she finished all the good ones, she would be such a good reader, she could just tear through things like The Story of Sugar in a few minutes. She chose a bound volume of St. Nicholas magazine. This was full of good things. As she left the library, she met Mr. Buckle coming up the granite steps. He was supporting himself by means of brass railing. "Hello, Mr. Buckle," said Jane. "I am going to read every book in the library," she added, feeling exuberant again, now that she had something good. Mr. Buckle nodded his head up and down, beaming. He was out of breath, and he was hanging on to the brass railing. "It is cheating," Jane demanded. "If I don't read every word in this big book, it's not really a big book. It's a lot of magazines. Did you say to yourself, I am going to read every book in every magazine?" "No, every book." "Well then, it's not cheating." "But maybe a whole lot of magazines together makes a book." "It is very mystifying," agreed Mr. Buckle. "But I think once a magazine, always a magazine." Jane ran home the long way so she could race the trolley car to Ashbellow's place. She was a good runner and almost always beat the trolley to the corner. Running around to the backyard and climbing onto the high board fence, she peered through the apple trees. She hoped that Nancy Stokes would have come home from her piano lessons by now, but Nancy was nowhere in sight. She must have had to go somewhere with her mom. So Jane went around front and sat down on the little square porch to read St. Nicholas. The first story began in the middle of the night. In the middle of the night, it reminded Jane of her own position within the Moffat family. It was now definitely established that she was the middle Moffat. Mama introduced her as Jane, the middle Moffat, and not only to the Gillespie girls, but also to the new curate of the church, for whom she was making vestments and cassocks. Of course, the only person to whom she made that mistake about being the mysterious middle Moffat was Mr. Buckle, and as it turned out, this had not proved to be such a grave error anyway. In fact, he seemed to enjoy the game of Hawkshaw, the detective, very much. And if he liked it, and he was the oldest inhabitant and most important person in the town, it certainly had not done any harm, this calling herself the mysterious middle Moffat. It might have even, by keeping him in such good spirits, helped him live to be 100. Jane was doing all she could about that. For instance, she sometimes followed him from a distance to see that he crossed the street to safety and that no dogs jumped out at him unexpectedly, made him lose balance. And whenever she heard of a new family moving to Cranberry, she checked up immediately to find out how the oldest person in that family was. When she found out that there was no one 99 or over, she quickly told Mr. Buckles that he would know that he was still the oldest inhabitant in town. Janie tried to be nearby whenever the oldest inhabitant was shuffling past the firehouse, because the Cranberry fire alarm was the loudest in the whole state. What a blast when it went off, and it was so sudden. There was no warning at all. Jane always said politely when she joined him here, "Don't we have the loudest fire alarm here in Cranberry?" This was just to remind him to be on guard and steel himself in case it blew. And yes, she was doing everything she could to help him reach 100. Just this afternoon, running home from the library, she had kicked aside a fallen branch, a broken bottle, an orange peel, so the way would be clear when Mr. Buckle came home. She even occasionally carried around an old umbrella so that he would not get caught in the rain. Of course, she did not spend her whole time this way, but she did as much as she could. Once she had seen Mr. Buckle go out and she had followed at a distance with the Moffat's big old umbrella, she really thought it might rain because the sparrows were chattering in the big elm tree in front of her house. Somebody told her once this was a sure sign of rain. When she reached the green, there he was blowing cotton to the birds. Puffs of cotton on the grass looked like dandelions gone to seed. Just as Janie arrived, the sky actually all of a sudden did turn black all over. The rain came marching up the street. She reached the oldest inhabitant and opened the umbrella over his head just as the big drops started to fall on his side of the street. "This is very mysterious," he said. "You're being on hand with the umbrella?" They had walked home together in the rain. Now, while Jane was rocking back and forth in the green rocker reading her St. Nicholas magazine, a fog began to roll in from the south. Jane looked up from her book. A fog, and it seemed to be growing thicker and thicker. She put her book down and watched it roll in. Soon she would be hardly see the lot across the street. This was going to be a really heavy fog, perhaps as good a fog as they had had in London. She ran down the steps and down the Moffat's long lawn, trying to separate the fog as though it were a gauzy curtain. Then she could see what was going on in the world. As she reached the sidewalk, she slipped on some damp autumn leaves and ran into Miss Buckle, the oldest daughter of the oldest inhabitant, who caught her in her arms. "Goodness, Jane, what a start you gave me. I'm afraid I'm going to be late to Professor Fairweather Browning's society. Goodbye, child." And she set Jane firmly on the walk. Jane watched the oldest inhabitant's daughter disappear in the fog. "Professor Fairweather?" Jane liked the way she said that. She never said Professor Fairweather, just Professor Fairweather. Very fast. That was nice, the way she talked. Everything she said sounded so important. Well, Miss Buckle was going to the Browning Society, leaving the oldest inhabitant all alone. Jane hoped he had gotten home from the library in the fog safely. Supposing some witch who was exactly 100 was jealous of him and had snatched him down under the squash vines that grew so thickly all over one corner of the lot. That's the way it might be if this were a fairy tale and not Ashbella's place. However, fairy tale or not, she decided to spend the afternoon with the oldest inhabitant so he would not be tempted to go out in the fog. Once the oldest inhabitant had said to her, "Come in and see my chicken bone furniture someday." Today would be a good chance to do this. Of course, she would not say that she had come to call on him to keep him from getting lost in the fog, but she would say that she had come to see his chicken bone furniture. Besides, she really owed him a visit since he had come to her organ recital. Jane ran into her house to get her knitting, for she intended to stay with the oldest inhabitant until the fog lifted. She marched up the street and onto Mr. Buckle's porch. She walked right in. She tiptoed through the little parlor with the black horse hair chairs sofa, and she went into the sitting room, where the oldest inhabitant was bent over a big book. He balanced it halfway on his knees and halfway on the little oval-shaped table beside him. "Hello, Mr. Buckle," said Jane politely. "Hello, Jane," said the oldest inhabitant. "I've come to see the bones," said Jane. "Ah, yes," said the oldest inhabitant, "the chicken bone furniture." Jane glanced around the room. She had never been in this house before. On one wall was a picture of the ruins of Pompeii, and on another was a picture of a lot of sheep huddled together in a blizzard. There was a picture exactly like this in Nancy's house. Jane preferred color pictures, such as the one the Moffats had in their green and white parlor, of a milkmaid leading home the cows. The oldest inhabitant showed her a little glass cabinet in the corner of the room. This held the furniture he had carved out of chicken bones. Jane stood with her hands behind her back so Mr. Buckle would not think she would touch things and break them. She looked at the chicken bone furniture in amazement. What lovely little things. Tiny tables, chairs, cupboards, beds, a sofa, a bookcase, with what looked like real little books, and even the tiniest of clocks. "Oh, how nice," exclaimed Jane. "Yes, those are all carved out of chicken bones. Every piece. I did them all by hand." "My," said Jane, "what a lot of chickens you must have eaten." "Yes," said the oldest inhabitant. "They are very famous. Peabody Museum is asking them all the time. My daughter frequently suggests that I give them to the museum, but I like to keep them here." Jane admired the chicken bone furniture for quite some while. The oldest inhabitant sat down on his little rocking chair again. Now that Jane had seen the chicken bone furniture, she wondered if the oldest inhabitant expected her to go home. He had gone home after the organ recital, but first they had cookies and grape juice. He might think if she stayed longer that she wanted something to eat, but she had resolved to stay until the fog lifted or Miss Buckle came home. However, she couldn't look at the chicken bone furniture the whole afternoon, and he might get alarmed if she sat down and took out her knitting. He might think, "Goodness, is she going to stay all day?" That's what the Moffats always thought when Miss Price arrived and sat down with her knitting, for she usually did spend the entire afternoon there, while everyone else was wanting to do something else. Fortunately, the oldest inhabitant spoke just then and relieved Jane of her embarrassment. "Well, Middle Moffat, now we have seen the chicken bone furniture. How would you like to look at pictures through a stereoscope?" "That would be nice," agreed Jane. The oldest inhabitant went to a little closet in the corner and came back with a pile of pictures and the stereoscope. He put the pile of pictures on the table beside him and sat down. Jane pulled up a chair. "Now, you fit the pictures in and we'll look," said Mr. Buckle. So Jane fitted a picture in the stereoscope and passed it to the oldest inhabitant, who adjusted it to his eyes. He peered at it with his white head thrust a little forward. Then he handed it to Jane, and she adjusted it to her eyes. One by one, they went through all the pictures this way. When it was Jane's turn to look, she never knew exactly how long she should look. She didn't want to look too long and make the oldest inhabitant tired of waiting for the next picture. She didn't want to look too little and give the impression she was not appreciating the beauty of the scene. At length, she decided to count up to 10, slowly. There. That was a good, polite time to look at each one, she thought. It really was funny how those two same pictures on the cards jumped together into one picture when you looked at them through the stereoscope. In real life, they look like picture postcards with two identical pictures separated by a line down the middle. But through the stereoscope, the two pictures hop together into one. How the man walking along the woody path suddenly jumped out at you, a real man in a straw hat. The mountains stood out from one another. The waterfall looked as though it might splash you. A castle hidden in the trees suddenly emerged. You could almost pick the flowers, especially the edelweiss. There was a nearness and a fairness to those pictures, as though you were standing at the top of Shingle Hill, looking at real scenery. But of course, these scenes were of the Alps, not Shingle Hill. One picture showed an old Swiss with a long white beard sitting in front of his old mountain cottage. Goats were nibbling in the grass. Maybe the Alms uncle and Heidi, thought Jane. Another oldest inhabitant, said Mr. Buckle, laughing. Jane smiled at him and looked a longer time, counting up to 15 at this one. When they had finished looking at the pictures, the oldest inhabitant said, I see you brought your knitting. Yes, said Jane, a scarf for the soldiers in France. She held it up for him to see. She wished she could knit red rose and blue rose for a change. Maybe she could change it into a helmet. It was not long enough for a scarf yet, but it was nearly long enough for a helmet. Would you change this into a helmet, she asked the oldest inhabitant. It's supposed to be a scarf? Yes, my goodness. Changing scarfs into helmets? The mysterious middle Moffat, exclaimed the oldest inhabitant. Jane laughed, and whoops, she lost the stitch. Catch it, shouted the oldest inhabitant, as though it were a runaway horse. Jane sat down and clumsily recaptured the stitch. Narrow escape, said Mr. Buckle. My goodness, thought Jane. He shouldn't shout like that. I better not drop any more stitches. She knit one or two rows in silence, and the oldest inhabitant watched her for a while, then bent his head over his book. All you could hear now in the house was the sound of Janie's knitting needles clicking together, the soft breath of the oldest inhabitant, and the tick-tock of the comfortable clock on the mantel. Mr. Buckle breathed in to the clock's tick and out to the clock's talk. Jane knit and clock tick-tocked. The quiet made her sleepy. She heard coal being dumped into Clara Pringle's cellar. Bag after bag rattled down the chute. What a lot of bags of coal they are getting. Good, hard, black coal. Must be enough for at least a year. In the Moffat's house, they never had more than one bag of coal at a time. She heard an occasional horse and wagon joggle by, clop, clop. And she heard Joey call, Rufus! Mama wants you to come home. All these noises sounded like miles away. Jane thought she would like to stretch her legs now and look out of the window and see if she could see any of these things that were going on out in the fog. But of course, she did not do this. The oldest inhabitant might get into his head that she did not like sitting here or that he should offer her something to eat. She looked at the oldest inhabitant to see if he had gone to sleep, but he hadn't, and he surprised her very much by saying, how about a good game of double solitaire now? Double solitaire, her favorite game. She and Joey and Rufus played it all the time. She nodded her head up and down. She would play slowly and let him win, she thought. She was the quickest double solitaire player of the Moffats. That was one thing, like running, that she was very good at. and made Rufus mad. She went so fast. She would be careful not to go too fast for the oldest inhabitant. Mr. Buckle pushed aside the lamp, a small plaster model of the Yale Bowl, a copy of the National Geographic, and the red fringed tablecloth. This table had a white marble top, wonderful for games. He pulled out a little drawer that was ordinarily hidden by the tablecloth and took out two decks of playing cards. Jane pulled her chair around opposite him and they were ready to begin. He gave her one deck of cards. Shuffle, he bade her. Jane separated her pack of cards into two piles and shuffled one into the other. The oldest inhabitant did not like the way she shuffled. This is not the way to shuffle, he said. This is the way to shuffle. He held the pack in his left hand, took some of the cards out with his right hand, and shuffled them back and forth so fast you couldn't see him. He was the fastest shuffler Jane had ever known. There, he said, now we are ready to begin. They laid out the cards neatly for the game, and all was ready. The oldest inhabitant bit out the words like a sergeant giving a command. Start! The cards flew. Slap down the ace of hearts. Who would get the two on first? The oldest inhabitant. Slap on the three. The four. Ace of spades. Slap down the two. The three. Who would get four on first? The oldest inhabitant. He flipped the cards through the air between plays. The cards were flying. Slap on the jack, the queen, the king. Look at the diamonds. Build up the diamond pile. Who had the seven? Janie. Put it on quick. Down with the eight, the nine. The oldest inhabitant got his card there first almost every time. When he didn't, he put the card on the edge of the table, flipped it lightly in the air, making it turn a somersault. Caught it neatly between his thumb and forefinger and returned it to its proper place while Jane was racing for the next card. Flying through the air, ace of spades, hearts, twos, threes, jacks, queens, everything. Jane's head spun. Her eyes felt cross. She played faster than she had ever played in her whole life in order to uphold the honor of the Moffats. Let the oldest inhabitant win, pooh, not to be licked hollow the way she licked Clara Pringle. That's all she hoped for now. The oldest inhabitant was winning, and not because she was letting him either. Letting him? What a foolish thought. The oldest inhabitant, a veteran of the Civil War, sat on the reviewing stand for every important occasion and gave out the diplomas at graduation, soon to be 100 years old. What had she been thinking? Letting him win. Of course a man such as this would win. Mr. Buckle flipped his last card, the King of Hearts, into the air. It turned a neat somersault right smack down on the heart pile. The oldest inhabitant had won. There he beamed, rocking back and forth in his chair, his hands on his knees, watching while Jane finished up her last cards. Gee, gasped Jane, you're some player. Shall we have another game, or is it time for Nellie? She doesn't like to play doubles. And at that very moment, the front door opened. The oldest inhabitant swept all the cards into the little drawer, yanked the tablecloth back into place, and the Yale bowl, too, just in time. Hello, Father, and why, hello, Jane, said Miss Buckle, bustling in the room, the cherries on her hat shaking and rattling together. I declare, Professor Fairweather, what an inspiration, my. Jane backed out of the room and out of the house, scarcely able to say goodbye. Goodness, what a game! Her head was whirling and she felt dizzy. She must practice that card trick, the one in which she flipped the card off the edge of the table and caught it neatly between thumb and forefinger. That would impress Joey and Rufus and Nancy Stokes, too. Watch me, she'd say. The cards would flip through the air the way they had for the oldest inhabitant. And that is the end of chapter 4. And hello, little girl. I love you very much. I miss you very much. I think that is a different one. Happy Thanksgiving. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Love you, kiddo. See you soon.